The unopinionated nature of React is a two-edged sword. On the one hand, you get freedom of choice. On the other hand, many projects end up with a custom and often messy architecture. This video is the fifth part of a series about software architecture and React apps, where we take a code base with lots of bad practices and refactor it step by step. See my playlist named React Architecture for more videos and check the article linked in the description, where you can find a waitlist for the course. Previously, we created the initial API layer and extracted fetch functions, added data transformations, and separated domain entities and DTOs to isolate our UI code from the server. But we're not done yet. In this video, we're finalizing the API layer. We will create infrastructure services and use dependency injection where it's valuable. This way, it'll be easy to unit test data access logic. Another step towards a cleaner architecture. Let's have a look at a problematic code example. Here's a fetch function in the API layer that transforms input and output data and sends an API request. And here's a component that uses the above function. It imports the media API among others. Then it uploads an image in a form submit handler. A quick side note, if you're thinking we should use a library for server state management like React Query instead of manually fetching data in a use effect, you're right, but for now let's stay tool agnostic. We'll get to React Query in a future video. So what's the problem? When we started refactoring this codebase, we initially created simple fetch functions that had one job, sending API requests. But over time, we added more responsibilities. In this case, data transformations. While this isn't too bad, we started mixing concerns. At the same time, this code isn't very testable as we'd have to mock the API client or set up a mock server, for example with mock service worker, all for unit testing a bit of logic. On top of that, there's a good chance that the backend folks have to change the API at some point. They might adjust the response data or introduce breaking changes in a new version of the endpoint. In a larger team with different deploy pipelines and release cycles for the backend and frontend, this can be difficult to manage. In our case, the upload image function is a good place to add the code that switches between the old and the new endpoint. Take this as an illustrative example, not something I'd necessarily use in production. This is logic that you want to test, but again, we'd have to mock the API client or set up a mock server. So what's the solution? The goal is to refactor the code to have separate concerns and simplify writing unit tests. This will take us a few simple steps from separating the upload image function into a service and API client, wrapping it in a singleton class, and using dependency injection for testability. Let's start with the first step. First, let's copy this file as we need this code in a bit. Then we start by going back to square one. We remove all logic from the upload image function. This function now has a single responsibility, connecting to the server's REST API. It sends a POST request and returns the response data. This is exactly how we started the refactoring a couple of weeks ago. Next, we move all the logic to a separate file. Since this code is more logic heavy, it probably makes sense to call it a service. This looks almost like what we had before. But now the service function only focuses on data transformation. The implementation details of the API request, like the path, method, and the exact response data structure, aren't its concern anymore. Now, we still have the same problem with testability though. We'd have to mock the media API. This is probably a bit easier than mocking the Axios client, but it's still not ideal. So let's continue with step 2. Dependency injection felt like a mystery to me for a long time, probably because of all the magic happening in, for example, Angular. But actually, the core principle is quite simple. Let me show you. So far, the media service imports the media API and calls its upload image function. The service is in control of the import and thus has a dependency on the media API. Now let's invert the control. We wrap the service function upload image in a class and let it accept the media API as parameter in its constructor. Now we see an error. Media API is not a TypeScript type. So let's quickly create an interface. Finally, we use the interface in the service constructor. Now let me explain. The trick is that the service stores the API instance as a private variable. Then in the upload image method, this variable is used to call the API function. This is called dependency injection, as we inject the media API dependency into the service. Now the code that instantiates the service is in control of the implementation of the media API. This becomes obvious as the media service is now independent of the media API implementation. It doesn't import from the API file anymore. Instead, it imports the media API's TypeScript interface. With the use of this interface, we define a contract. The service says that it expects an object with the upload image function and the respective parameter and return value. The important part? It doesn't care about the implementation of this function. We can provide any object that matches this TypeScript interface. And that comes in handy if we want to write a unit test. I mentioned it before, with the original implementation of the media API, we would have to mock the Axis client or use a mock server. Now with our new service that uses dependency injection, testing is pretty simple. Let me paste this code quickly and walk you through. First, we create a mock media API and instantiate the service with it. This mock has to match the interface we defined in the last step, otherwise TypeScript shows an error. Then we use it to create the service instance. We then call the uploadImage function, providing a mock file as an input parameter. Finally, we assert that the service returns the correct value based on the input type. You see, we didn't need to mock any files. Instead, we created a simple mock implementation of the media API interface and passed it to the service. A nice little unit test enabled by dependency injection. Note, I don't think we necessarily need to test simple data transformations, but as soon as the service contains more logic, like switching between API versions, unit tests could be really valuable. Now onto the next step. Since we wrapped the service function in a class, we can't directly export it in the bearer file anymore. Instead, we use another design pattern, a singleton. A singleton is used whenever you want to expose a single instance of a class to the rest of the application. This fits our situation well. We only need one instance of the media service in our UI code. Technically, you'd use a private constructor and a getInstance function in the class. This way, the class is responsible for creating the instance once and returning an existing instance if available. In our case, we don't need this though. We can simply use our bearer file to create one instance and export it. In fact, in our case, it's not really important for us if there's only one instance. This might be different if we, for example, establish a WebSocket connection. But here, this approach is sufficient. Next, we need to update our components. Actually, there's not much to do, as the service's bearer file still exports the same interface. But before we address the component, let me quickly rename the API folder to something more neutral like infrastructure. The name API provides a clue about the underlying data connection, a REST API. This is an implementation detail from the perspective of the UI code. Using a more generic name like infrastructure instead decouples the UI from this knowledge. Okay, now in the component the only change is to rename the import from media API to media service. Let's do the same for the other services we still have to refactor. Finally, we fix the import order. Okay, that's it for the refactoring in this video. But you might ask yourself, is this always necessary? No, it's not. We've seen that creating services in the infrastructure layer can increase testability, but we also introduced more code. This is always a trade-off. In many situations, you might not need this additional abstraction. For example, if your services only contain simple data transformation logic, you might not need unit tests for them. With TypeScript, you can rely on the interfaces or types that your transformer accepts and returns. The actual implementation can then be tested with integration tests. Those should fail if something breaks in the infrastructure layer. Also, a service might not be necessary if your API fetch functions don't contain logic. Then there's no point in testing them. Again, integration tests should be sufficient in this scenario. Here's one example from the project. A quote-unquote service that connects to authentication endpoints so the user can log in and log out. There's really not much going on there. For consistency, we could create a service with dependency injection as described above, but that would be merely an empty wrapper around the fetch functions. Instead, we can directly export the API client. The UI code doesn't care if we exported a real service or if we export these API functions directly. And in case we'd have to add more logic that we wanted to unit test, we could still create a service class and export it in the bearer file instead. As long as the interface stays the same, the UI code doesn't need to change. Let me quickly wrap up mentioning the pros and cons of a global infrastructure layer. We created the infrastructure layer as a global layer that uses services and dependency injection, where unit tests are useful. But as always, there's no silver bullet, and depending on your project, there might be different trade-offs. Here are some advantages. First, our infrastructure layer isolates the UI code from data access. If the server API changes at some point, we might be able to deal with it inside the infrastructure service. For example, if the user's full name was returned as one field before, but is now split into first and last name, the service could return the combined name. Nothing in the UI would need to change. That doesn't always work, of course. Second, logic inside the infrastructure services can easily be unit tested. That's often much easier and faster than having to write integration tests for different scenarios inside data access logic. Third, we can reuse the service within the application. No need to duplicate data access logic in different parts of the codebase. Fourth, the infrastructure layer is completely independent of the UI framework of our choice. We could migrate from React to the next shiny framework and keep all the code in this layer. We could move it to a separate NPM package to make the code available to other applications or micro frontends. Or we could move it to a backend for frontend service if needed. Now, the disadvantages. With this structure, we created overhead and complexity. In small projects, it's easier to keep the fetch functions close to your components. It's simpler to get an overview and to debug. Second, there's a risk of introducing empty wrappers. As mentioned, if you value consistency, you might, for example, create services for API functions that don't contain any logic. You might want to be pragmatic and use these patterns only if they provide value. Third, this kind of architecture is not that common for React apps, at least from my experience. So any new developer has to be onboarded on the codebase and its conventions. But to be honest, due to the unopinionated nature of React, many projects have kind of custom architecture anyway. That's it for this time. Check out the other videos in the playlist and the accompanying article linked in the description. There you can also find a waitlist for a course focused on software architecture and React applications. Next time, we'll move closer to the UI components, where we'll extract business logic from the component by introducing use cases.